Good morning. Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to our service of worship here today as we gather together to worship Almighty God. It is my prayer that you'll be blessed and that he will be glorified. And if you're visiting with us today, it is you are especially welcome. Am I coming through on them mics? Nothing. Hold on 1 second. Our technical problem has been resolved. So for the benefit of those who listen to this online, I'd like to welcome you here for our service of worship here today as we gather together to worship Almighty God. I pray that you will be blessed and that he will be glorified. Now, before we begin our worship, our approach God in worship, I have a couple of things by way of announcements, a couple of which are on the announcement sheets and a couple of items aren't. I'll start with those on the announcement sheet first. Firstly, the Salzer Prayer Letter, the prayer letter for the Soldiers and Airmen Scripture Readers Association for August is available in the vestibule. If you pray for this work, please pick up one of those on the way out. You'll notice on your announcement sheet that there is a planning meeting tomorrow evening at 8 p.m. in the Bailey Room of the Bailey Hall for those who have expressed an interest in helping run the Senior Citizens Fellowship Group, the name of which we haven't come up with yet. But there's a planning meeting to decide sort of format and frequency, etc. And so if you have put your name down to help with that, please come along to that meeting tomorrow. And even if you haven't put your name down, but you would like to help run this group, please come along tomorrow evening. Members of Kirk Session, please take note of the Kirk Session meeting scheduled to take place on Thursday, the 1st of September. And members of committee, please take note of the meeting scheduled to take place on Tuesday, the 6th of September. And also, if you are someone who is interested in coming forward for communion for the first time, becoming a communicant member of this congregation, please speak to me as soon as possible. Other items that, a couple of which are not on the announcement sheet, is firstly, I would like to thank everyone who helped with the clean-up here held during the week, Tuesday evening. It was great to see so many men, and indeed Lynn was down as well at one stage with a rag cleaning windows. So it's good to see so many people down helping with the clean-up around the church. Thank you to all who helped with that. With regards to Holiday Bible Club, I'd like to thank you for your prayers regarding that. We had a very successful Holiday Bible Club Monday through to Friday of the week that's just gone. Jonathan Graham and his team, once again, well received. We had an average over 30 children every day, 35 children thereabouts most days. So it was great to see so many children from indeed this church and the neighbourhood, in the surrounding area, I should say, coming to sit under God's word as Jonathan and his team brought it to them. Our youth club will, God willing, start back again on Friday the 16th of September, and we had a meeting on Friday night just to discuss a few bits and pieces, and it was brought up that it would be good if we had Lego for the children to play with. Now, therefore, if you have any Lego that's stashed away in the attic, you're no longer playing with, okay, and that includes adults, okay, and you'd like to donate it for the youth club, please speak to me and we will gladly take that from you and put it to good use in the youth club. And then finally, it is with deep regret that I announce the death of David Kelly, late of Crossowen Park. David passed away peacefully early this morning at home. Funeral arrangements have yet to be confirmed, but they will take place during this incoming week here in this church. But in the meantime, can I ask you to please remember David's family in your prayers for their bereavement. I'm going to read to you now from Psalm 93, just to focus our minds upon Almighty God. The Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed in majesty and armed with strength. Indeed, the world is established firm and secure. Your throne was established long ago. You are from all eternity. The seas have lifted up, Lord, the seas have lifted up their voice. The seas have lifted up their pounding waves. Mightier than the thunder of the great waters, mightier than the breakers of the sea, the Lord on high is mighty. Your statutes, Lord, stand firm. Holiness adorns your house for endless days. And as we reflect upon the greatness of our God, let us stand to sing our opening praise, Come People of the Risen King. People of the Risen King, once more, let us pray. Merciful God, loving, gracious, and eternal Heavenly Father, as we approach you now in prayer, we do so thankful for this opportunity to come before you. What an immense privilege it is, O Lord, for us who are the work of your hands, formed from the dust of the earth, to call upon you in this way. Who are we, O Lord? Who are we, O Lord, that you should bless us in this way? Heavenly Father, we may ask such a question, but we already know the answer because, as your word declares, it is because you are merciful, you are compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love and faithfulness. You, O Lord, are more ready to receive us than we are to approach you. You are more ready to listen to us than we are to talk to you. You are more ready to give than we are to receive. You are more ready to forgive than we are ready to ask. You are more ready to take our burdens from us than we are to give them to you. And you're more ready to offer us your grace than we are to seek it. Heavenly Father, your generosity towards us is therefore a reflection of your character, not ours. So forgive us for forgetting this and for believing that we are entitled to receive all the blessings that you shower us with daily. We thank you, Lord, that you do not treat us as our sins deserve. For while we still have breath in our bodies, we have the opportunity to seek your mercy and to ask for forgiveness in Christ's name. We thank you, Lord, that like the thief crucified alongside your Son at Calvary, all we need to do is humbly ask and believe in order to receive. Heavenly Father, have mercy upon us this day, we pray. Forgive our sinfulness in attitude, thought, word, and action. Forgive us, O Lord, for the things we should not have done, and also for the things we did not do but should have. Forgive us, O Lord, for the times when, like Judas, we have betrayed you, because we thought more of this world than we do of you. Forgive us, O Lord, for the times when, like Peter, we have denied you, because we fear mankind more than we fear you. Forgive us, O Lord, for the times when, like Thomas, we have doubted you, because we put more store in our own wisdom and in our own abilities than we do in you and yours. Heavenly Father, have mercy upon us, we pray, and forgive us. Heavenly Father, draw near to us now. Cleanse our hearts, we pray, and by the power and indwelling presence of your Holy Spirit, help us to seek first your kingdom and your righteousness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer, for we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. If you have your Bibles with you, I would encourage you to open them at our reading, which is this morning is taken from Genesis chapter 4. As you know, when I've been with you, we've been reading through Genesis. This morning we come to chapter 4. So if you have your Bibles with you, please open them at this particular passage, and if you're using one of the pew Bibles, it can be found on page 6. It's Genesis chapter 4, and we will begin reading at verse 1. This is God's word. Adam lay with his wife Eve, and she became pregnant and gave birth to Cain. She said, "With the help of the Lord, I have brought forth a man." Later she gave birth to his brother Abel. Now Abel kept flocks and Cain worked the soil. In the course of time Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. But Abel brought fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favour on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering he did not look with favour. So Cain was very angry and his face was downcast. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must master it." Now Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let's go out to the field." And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is your brother Abel?" "I don't know," he replied. "Am I my brother's keeper?" The Lord said, "What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you are under a curse and driven from the ground, which opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it will no longer yield its crops for you. You will be a restless wanderer on the earth." Cain said to the Lord, "My punishment is more than I can bear. Today you are driving me from the land, and I will be hidden from your presence. I will be a restless wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me." But the Lord said to him, "Not so. If anyone kills Cain, he will suffer vengeance seven times over." Then the Lord put a mark on Cain so that no one who found him would kill him. So Cain went out from the Lord's presence and lived in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Cain lay with his wife, and she became pregnant and gave birth to Enoch. Cain was then building a city, and he named it after his son Enoch. To Enoch was born Irad, and Irad was the father of Mahujael. Mahujael was the father of Methushael. Methushael was the father of Lamech. Lamech married two women, one named Adah and the other Zillah. Adah gave birth to Jabal. He was the father of those who live in tents and raise livestock. His brother's name was Jubal. He was the father of all who play the harp and flute. Zillah also bore a son, Tubal-Cain, who forged all kinds of tools out of bronze and iron. Tubal-Cain's sister was Nema. Lamech said to his wives, Adah and Zillah, "Listen to me. Wives of Lamech, hear my words. I have killed a man for wounding me, a young man for injuring me. If Cain is avenged seven times, then Lamech 77 times." Adam lay with his wife again, and she gave birth to a son and named him Seth, saying, "God has granted me another child in place of Abel, since Cain killed him." Seth also had a son, and he named him Enosh. And at that time, men began to call on the name of the Lord. And we end our reading at verse 26, and thank God for this reading from His truth. Now I want to speak to the young people for a few moments. Now, can any of you tell me what this is? If you bring it up on the screen, Richard, for those screening from the back. Anybody? Compass, thank you. Now, what would I, or what do I use a compass for? What might I use this for? Anybody? Anna? To find your way? To find your way about? Okay, that's right. To find, to help you find your way. Now, for instance, when I used to do a lot of hill walking, and when I was out hill walking, in the days before, you could simply open up your phone and tap on the navigation app using SatNav, satellite navigation. Before you had one of these things to tell you where you were, you had to rely on one of these and one of these. What's this? A map. Thank you. A map. Okay. Now, the compass is a special piece of equipment in that inside that compass is a little needle with a pointer on it. Okay, and this needle floats on some liquid, and it always points north. That needle always points north. No matter where you are, it will always point north. Now, of course, there are four points on the compass. What are those four points? The directions, anybody? Anna? Yes, north, south, east, west. Bring them all, thank you. Well done. Okay, north, south, east, and west. So because this needle always points north, if I look at it, if I want to move to the east, all I need to do is look at my compass, and once I know where north is, I will know where east is. Okay? And vice versa. If I want to know west is, I look at where north is, etc., etc. Any direction I want to head in, as soon as I know the direction of north, it will tell me where the direction of all those other are. For instance, as I as I look at my compass, now it's telling me north is out that direction. Okay? Now, because the compass always points north, I can always trust what it tells me. I know as long as I trust my compass when I'm using my map that I cannot go wrong. Now, I remember many years ago, before any of you were born, in the days the dinosaurs roamed the earth, okay, when I was young, a young man, yes, and I know looking at me you think there's no way that that man was young at one stage, but I was. Okay, I was in the jungle in Central America. Now, what's the jungle? What's now the name for the jungle? Anybody? Rainforest? What's in the jungle? Anybody? Monkeys, definitely monkeys. Anything else?
Crocodiles.
There were crocodiles. Annie, you going to stick your hand up? Snakes, plenty of them. Okay, lots of wildlife. Okay, and lots and lots and lots of trees and birds. Okay? Now, I was in the jungle of Central America, and I had to lead a group of men from one place to another. We knew where we were to start off with. At my map, I knew where my start point was, and so I knew where I had to go to, and when I set my compass bearing, I knew the direction I had to march in with these men following me. Now, in the jungle, okay, with all these trees around you, things look the same, they look very confusing, okay? But I knew as long as I trusted my compass, I would get to where we needed to be. All I had to do was follow the direction it was telling me to go in. Even though at times it seemed to me like we were heading in the wrong direction, even though I looked around me and thought, surely this is wrong, this looks wrong. I looked at my compass and the compass said, no, we need to go that way. That is where we went. I trusted my compass and we got to exactly where we needed to be. What would have happened though? If I had looked at my compass and thought, ugh, that thing's telling me lies, I can't trust it. That doesn't look the right way. I'm going to head off over here. I'm going to go back over there. What would have happened if I'd done that? Anybody? I'd have got lost. Okay? If I had ignored my compass, I would have headed off in the wrong direction. And I would have got, along with the guys with me, would have got completely lost. Hopelessly lost. We wouldn't have had a clue where we were. But as it was, the compass kept me right. All I had to do was believe what it told me. And you know, boys and girls, this compass is a lot like God's Word, the Bible. The compass tells me which direction I need to travel in order to be where I want to be. And in a similar way, the Bible tells us what we need to do in order to get to heaven. Now, if I asked you and all of the adults here in this church, in fact, if I asked any adult beyond the walls of this church, if they want to get to heaven, I would say that everybody I asked that question to would say, yes, I want to get to heaven. I think I can safely say that every person I asked that question to would say yes. But here's the thing. Unless I do what the Bible tells me, I will never ever get to heaven. It may seem right to me. What I may think I know a different way, which may seem right to me. It may feel as though I am heading in the right direction. But if it isn't what the Bible has told me to do, then in actual fact, I am hopelessly lost. The Bible tells us that we need to have our sins forgiven and that the only way for this to happen is to ask Jesus Christ to be our Savior and Lord. There was no other way by which we can have our sins forgiven and get to heaven. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the things that guide us in this world. Tell us how to get from where we are to where we want to be. We thank you, Lord, for your word, the Bible, which tells us how we may get to heaven. We thank you, Lord, it gives us the direction we need to go and tells us what we need to do. We thank you for your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who sacrificed himself upon that cross at Calvary for our sins. And your word, the Bible, tells us all we need to do is put our trust in him and ask him to be our Savior. And Lord, as we trust, O Lord, the things in this world to guide us, help us to trust your word in this matter. Amen. And now we're going to stand to sing our children's hymn, which the children sang very enthusiastically during our holiday Bible club. One way God said to get to heaven. Let us stand to sing.
God said to get to
we're going to unite our hearts in prayer once again, this time with our prayer of intercession. So let us bow our heads. Heavenly Father, as we unite our hearts in prayer once again, we take this opportunity to remember the situation in Afghanistan 1 year on since the Taliban took control of that country. Heavenly Father, we pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ in Afghanistan who now live with the fear of arrest, torture, imprisonment, and even being put to death for their faith. We pray, O Lord, that in those circumstances which we simply cannot fathom, we pray, Lord, that you would protect them, strengthen and encourage them. May, O Lord, they see the power of your Holy Spirit at work in their lives, in the lives of those around them, and the local authorities. May those who seek to eradicate your church from that land be transformed by the gospel, which, as your word declares, is the power of God unto salvation. We pray, Lord, for the country of Afghanistan as a whole, given the collapse of the economy, the lack of international aid, and severe shortage of food. Heavenly Father, such is the desperation of some people in that land. Parents have taken to selling their daughters in order to raise enough money to feed the rest of their family. We therefore pray, O Lord, that the international community would provide sufficient funding to both government and charitable agencies working in Afghanistan to support the millions of people who have no means to provide for themselves or their families. Lord, we here are in the midst of a cost of living crisis, but in that country, Lord, they don't have any food nor even any money to buy it with. Therefore, Lord, we pray that you'd have mercy and give and enable support to be given to that country. In our own land, O Lord, we pray for our government in this current period of flux as the Conservative Party continue with the process of choosing a new leader, and therefore our Prime Minister. And we pray, Lord, that whoever wins this leadership race, that they would be blessed with the wisdom, courage and compassion they need to deal with the economic and international crisis we as a country face. At home here, O Lord, we pray for those of our young people who have received exam results and those who have yet to do so. We pray that those results, they would know your wisdom in planning their next steps. Be with them and their families at this stage, we pray, which is so often such a stressful time. May they know your peace, we pray. Lord, we also pray for this, your church, here in Clogher. And we seek, Lord, your blessing upon all that we do here in your name. Lord, we pray for spiritual and physical growth. We pray that you'd raise up and equip the next generation of people to bear the light of your gospel in this corner of your kingdom. We pray, Lord, this morning for the family of David Kelly, as they, O Lord, come to terms with his death. And we ask, O Lord, that they would know your peace and grace, O Lord, as they grieve his loss. We pray, Heavenly Father, for those known to us in this congregation and the wider community who are currently unwell. We ask, Lord, that you would bless them with your healing touch. And, Lord, that you would grant their anxious loved ones peace and reassurance. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For we ask all of these things in Christ's name. Amen. If you have your Bibles with you, I'd encourage you to open them at Genesis chapter 4, which we read from a few moments ago, so you can follow along as we look at it together. Now, back in July, before I took my summer break, we looked at Genesis 3, which charts the fall of mankind when Adam and Eve rebelled against God and sin entered into the world. Back then, one of the things we considered was the consequences of sin and how it affected mankind's relationship with God, with fellow human beings, and with the environment around us. Adam and Eve may have been the ones that ate the forbidden fruit, but they were not the only ones affected by the fallout. Nothing would be as it had been before. The poison of sin had entered the world and it contaminated all before it. Adam and Eve were cast out of the Garden of Eden and the nearer presence of God. Once they had enjoyed unbroken close fellowship with their covenant Redeemer. Now their sin came between him and them. Once they had enjoyed life in the way that the Lord God had intended, now they were reduced to simply existing without the source of true life. Adam and Eve had learned the hard way that God's word is to be taken seriously. It can be trusted and it will be fulfilled. They had learned to their cost that God is not to be treated lightly. Now, following their forced exit from the Garden of Eden, you can imagine them trying to pick up the pieces of their lives, as it were, and attempting to make the best of an unsatisfactory situation, which they were the authors of. And as we turn to chapter 4, for a few brief moments, it appears that they had turned a corner, so to speak, as life seemed to be in the up, given that the Lord enabled them to have two children. But as we read on, it seems to become apparent that the ominous warning issued by God in chapter 3, verse 15, had become a reality. Therein, God spoke about the division of humanity into two distinct groups. The offspring of Satan, that is, those whom he has led into rebellion against God, and the offspring of the woman, which, in the context of that verse, is a reference to Christ and therefore alludes to all those who through faith in Christ are the children of God. So as we look at chapter 4 today, there are two things that I want us to consider. First being the escalation of sin. The second, the continuance of God's grace. The escalation of sin and the continuance of God's grace. Firstly then, the escalation of sin. As already mentioned, chapter 4 appears to begin positively, but once again, our English translation of the Hebrew script masks the reality of the situation. By the grace of God, he conceived and gave birth to Cain, which is a name is similar in sound to the Hebrew word for to acquire. Then, sometime later, she conceived and gave birth to Abel, which as a name means breath. That is to say, fleeting, which no doubt was an unwitting allusion to his short life. So therein the stage is set for what happened next. As verse 2 tells us, Abel kept flocks and Cain worked the land. And as verses 3 and 4 tell us, each of them brought an offering to the Lord. However, whilst Abel's offering found favour with the Lord, Cain's didn't. And from that point on, things deteriorated rapidly. This naturally leads to the question, what was it that caused the Lord to accept Abel's offering and reject Cain's? And the answer to that question lies in the verses that follow, which reveal Cain's character. So you see, it was not down to the offering themselves. It was not down to what each man brought to the Lord, but rather, it was the condition of the heart of the one presenting the offering. As verse 5 tells us, Cain, upon learning that his offering wasn't acceptable to God, became very angry. Not merely angry, very angry. So angry it was written on his face. In other words, he was furious that God would not accept what he had brought, which reveals that he believed that God had no right to reject his offering. It was akin to him saying, who does he think he is, rejecting what I have brought to him? How dare he reject my offering? This in turn highlights Cain's arrogance in that he thought he had the ability to decide what was acceptable to God and what wasn't. Abel's offering, on the other hand, was thoughtful and carefully selected, showing that he recognized and accepted God's greatness. Jewish scholars tell us that his offering, described as it is here, means that he gave the best of what he had, which means that he deemed God worthy of his respect and worship. Abel knew and accepted that he owed everything to God, even his very existence. So his offering, therefore, was a reflection of his gratitude and respect for God. This reminds us that God cannot be fooled by the outward aspects of worship. He knows the condition of our hearts. Therefore, he knows if it is authentic and heartfelt or if we are merely going through the motions. In Cain's case, it was the latter. Therefore, God expressed his dissatisfaction with him. And as we know, Cain did not take this news well. He was furious that God had deemed his offering unacceptable. This, of course, wasn't hidden from God. So, as verses 6 and 7 tell us, he gently warned Cain to be careful lest sin gain the upper hand on him. But God's words fell on deaf ears, because fueled by resentment, Cain turned his anger on his own kith and kin, his brother Abel. As verse 8 tells us, Cain lured his unsuspecting brother out into the field, whereupon he attacked and killed him. All Abel had done was present an offering to God that found favour with him. But in Cain's sin-ravaged mind, that was enough to kill him. Cain's parents had taken the forbidden fruit. Now he had taken his brother's life. The escalation of sin was having a tragic effect on humanity. But it didn't stop there. Verse 9 tells us that when God questioned Cain as to Abel's whereabouts, Cain told a barefaced lie to God. I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper? He said. But Cain found out that you cannot fool the one who sees and knows all things, because in verses 10 through to 12, God declared the punishment he would be subjected to for murdering his brother. Cain had alienated himself from God and his brother, and therefore God alienated him from the soil which he had worked, and he decreed that he would become a nomad, someone without a place to call home and the sense of security that comes with such a place. Now, you would have thought that God's words here would have jolted Cain back to reality, that they would have brought him to his senses. You would have thought that he would have confessed his sin and sought God's mercy, but such was the hardening of his heart. So polluted was his thinking by sin that instead of remorse, he only expressed self-pity. He said, my punishment is more than I can bear. Today you are driving me from the land, and I will be hidden from your presence. I will be a restless wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me. With those words, Cain not only accused God of being unjust in his punishment, but also of being limited in his abilities, in that he, Cain, thought that he would be hidden from God. This demonstrates that due to his sinfulness, Cain did not have a proper understanding of God, because if he did, he would have known that no one, not one single living being, is ever hidden from God's sight, regardless of where they are or whether it is day or night. Indeed, Cain hadn't even comprehended that God had known about his smouldering anger or the fact that he had sought to murder his brother in secret. It hadn't clicked with Cain that God had seen all of this nonetheless. Cain's words here revealed to us how he feared social isolation and the retribution of others more than he feared Almighty God himself, who made him. And tragically today, there are still so many people who make the same mistake. People who, fearing the rejection of this world, fear more the rejection of life in this world, or people in this world, they fear that more than they fear rejection by Almighty God in eternity. And therefore, because they fear the world more than they fear God, they reject the only means of salvation he offers them, through faith in Christ. But who are these other people that Cain feared, you may ask? And that is a reasonable question, given that at this stage there were only three people alive. Well, what we have to keep in mind here is that the author of Genesis is more focused on the human condition than on history in and of itself. So given that at this time in human history they lived longer lives than we do now, it appears that Cain feared, as the human population grew over the course of time, that some of them might well seek to avenge Abel's blood. Cain's attitude and actions here remind us that when we have a flawed understanding of God, then our ethics are also flawed. And what I mean by this is that if we do not acknowledge God for who he is and accept his sovereignty, then the principles we live by will not be grounded in the infallible truth of his word. And if this bedrock of truth is not our datum point, if it is not the fixed reference point by which we compare everything with, then we are prone to live by standards which we set for ourselves that are ultimately flawed. It also means that without such a datum point, as we get to make up our own rules, well, we can justify just about anything to ourselves. And the outcome of such thinking means that things such as greed, extortion, deceitfulness, immorality, racism, sexism, sectarianism, bigotry, and callousness, all these things and many more, will continue to blight us as a race and poison our societies, because they are manifestations of the flawed ethics that result from living our lives without reference to God and His Word. So this passage reveals to us the tragic consequences of the escalation of sin, but it also shows us the continuance of God's grace. As we know, Cain was filled with self-pity, and he complained to God about what he saw as the harshness of his punishment. But even though Cain was completely in the wrong, and even though he showed no sign of remorse whatsoever, God did not treat him as his sins deserved. Instead, he treated him with mercy that was completely undeserved. That is to say, grace. Cain feared retribution from others, so God promised to protect him. He declared that anyone who killed Cain would suffer vengeance seven times over, which is another way of saying that it would be a perfect measure appropriate to the crime. Seven being the number of perfection within Judaism. He also put a mark on Cain so that no one would touch him. What this mark was, we don't know. And as Scripture says, no more on the subject, we don't need to know. Therefore, we do, and we should not waste our time speculating as to what it was. All we do need to know is that God did put this mark on Cain, and it obviously worked because Cain did indeed lead a full life. And as we read through these verses, which tell us about the development of the human race and the development of civilization, initially through the line of Cain, we witness something that can easily be missed, namely that is the display of what is called or known as common grace. That is to say, God's grace, which is His spontaneous, unmerited mercy to believers and non-believers alike. Psalm 145 verse 9 declares, "The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all He has made." It is also something that Jesus Christ alluded to when teaching about love for enemies. Because speaking about God, He said, "He causes His sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous." This is all the more amazing, given that from verses 17 to 24, we read about how the family line of Cain expanded and about some of the notable achievements they made. But nowhere in those verses do we read about the change of heart from Cain, or for that matter, any of his descendants. It was quite the opposite, in fact. Cain, the nomad, took it upon himself to build a city, which in this context was a settlement protected by a wall or some other fortification. Thus, the man who was to have no place that he could call home, openly defied God and built himself one. Not only that, but despite being under the divine protection of God, by building himself a protected settlement as he did, Cain displayed a complete lack of faith in God's ability to keep His promise to him. In the Garden of Eden, God's provision for Adam and Eve had not been good enough for them, so they ate the forbidden fruit. And now God's protection wasn't good enough for Cain, so he put in place some of his own. But the rot didn't stop there. Because as civilization advanced, so did rebellion against God's word. Lamech, we are told, married two women, which was a direct contravention of God's template for marriage between one man and one woman. Not only that, but human life was further devalued, as Lamech proudly boasted about how he had killed the young man for merely wounding him. And as verse 24 tells us, he arrogantly declared, "If Cain is avenged seven times, then Lamech 77 times." Therein, Lamech was declaring that he could outdo God, and by consequence that he was to be more feared than God. So overall, as we read these verses, we find the author painting a tragic picture for us of civilization descending into the mire of sin, even as it was ascending in terms of numbers and ability. But despite this open act of rebellion against God, by people who had no thought whatsoever for Him, He was still gracious to them. He still gave them life and sustained them. He mitigated the effects of their sin, not handing them over fully to the depravity of it, and actually blessing the work of their hands. He enabled them to make technological advancements that benefited the human race as a whole, such as the making of musical instruments and tools. He also enabled them to make advancements in agricultural techniques so they could feed the growing population. He could have withheld such blessings, but he didn't. Instead, he was merciful. He did not treat them as their sins deserved. This common grace still applies today to the human race, regardless of whether or not they believe in or acknowledge God. Whether or not we acknowledge it, things such as every day of life, every achievement we make, every morsel of food that we have to eat, and every pound that we have in our pockets are evidence of God's common grace to all that he has made. So you see, no one can really say that they have no reason to thank and praise God, because the very fact that they can breathe is enough reason in and of itself. But this portion of Scripture also reveals another type of God's grace, known as special grace. And this is evident in verses 25 and 26, wherein the focus shifts from the line of Cain back to the line of Adam and Eve, or back to Adam and Eve, and how the Lord enabled Eve to conceive and give birth to another son, whom they named Seth. But just having read about the descent into sin by the line of Cain, you can easily miss the glimpse of special grace that we get here, whereby God preserved people who remained faithful to him. In verse 26, we're told that after Seth had a son called Enosh, at that time men began to call upon the name of the Lord. In other words, they began to acknowledge God for who he is, despite all of the darkness. The light had not gone out. God's plan for the salvation of mankind was being worked out, and no one or nothing could stop it. Today, God's special grace, or saving grace, as it is more commonly known, still abounds in that by the power and presence of the Holy Spirit, God calls people to repentance and faith in Christ, who shed his blood at Calvary for sin and rose again. So you see, it is called saving grace because all who receive it have their sins forgiven. They are saved from God's righteous wrath and are granted the gift of eternal life. All of us here today, and everyone beyond the walls of this building, are recipients of God's common grace. But how many of us are recipients of his saving grace? How many of us have come before God blaming no one but ourselves for our sin and have humbly sought his forgiveness in Christ's name? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace towards us, your spontaneous, unmerited mercy towards us, in giving us what we do not deserve and withholding what we do deserve. Heavenly Father, thank you for common grace in giving us what we need to live. We thank you for saving grace and giving us the gift of eternal life through faith in Christ. Lord, help us not to forget these two great truths. And may we, O Lord, be those who humbly accept Christ as our Saviour and be recipients of this saving grace. Amen. We're going to stand to sing our closing praise now. Marvellous grace of our loving Lord. Him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Saviour, be glory, majesty, power and authority. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest upon and abide with you forevermore.